Justin Timberlake, playing it safe, seeks Super Bowl redemption. At the 2004 Super Bowl halftime show, Janet Jackson performed her hits All For You and Rhythm Nation, a sensual club ballad and a militaristic funk stomp. She opened the performance and was there at its close, when Justin Timberlake, then a pop superstar a la vista, emerged to perform his hit Rock Your Body. If Ms. Jackson was glowing during her songs, she was shell-shocked during his, after Mr. Timberlake's hand tore her top and exposed her breast. Though the public punishment largely and unjustly accrued to Ms. Jackson, derailing her career, the affected song belonged to Mr. Timberlake. The sensible choice, 14 years later, when offered the opportunity for a clean slate, might have been to leave that song alone. Give it the night off. Don't wink. Nothing cute. But Mr. Timberlake's need for redemption is far greater than his capacity for restraint. And so in the second minute of his halftime show performance at Super Bowl LE, just after he'd pump-faked with his recent single, Filthy, he emerged on the US Bank Stadium field in Minneapolis and began singing, sort of, and dancing to Rock Your Body. If what happened in 2004 was a wardrobe malfunction, this was a taste malfunction, a seamy need to reclaim the song that, ever so briefly, put him uncomfortably under the Klieg lights and restore it to being just another benign entry in his pop soul catalog. Its use underscored the ways Ms. Jackson has been systematically erased from celebratory narratives around the Super Bowl, and also the way Mr. Timberlake's music is flattered most by soft light. At this point, his best songs are fit for aerobics, or soul cycle, or factories run by robots. Much of the urgency of his biggest hits comes from savvy production choices. He has a lissome voice, but all its victories come via seduction, not power. Regardless, he didn't much use it here, during a 13-minute performance that was heavy on dance spectacle, light on vocal authority. Often, it sounded as if Mr. Timberlake were merely providing accent riffs to his own songs. He leaned heavily, and rightly, on his first two albums, plowing through digital funk smashes like Cry Me a River, Sexy Back and My Love, and also the non-smash Suit and Tie, from the 2020's Experience. Only on the ballad Until the End of Time, during which he sat at a white piano, did he lean into his singing, allowing its natural tenderness to serve as a pyrotechnic. Mr. Timberlake got his start in a boy band, NSYNC, and he has a natural gift for grand-scale presentation. This was actually his third halftime performance, including 2004 and also NSYNC's appearance in 2001. The dance routines, including an exuberant tuxedo-clad brass section and a phalanx of bodies holding aloft mirrors that refracted light throughout the stadium, during mirrors, were effective without being ostentatious. Shows of this size are light work for Mr. Timberlake, even if he was working at about three-fourths the intensity of his backing troupe. That Mr. Timberlake, who has had a smattering of hits in recent years including the Trolls soundtrack anthem Can't Stop the Feeling, which he performed near the end of his set was offered this halftime show slot is a reminder of the wide-scale cultural cachet he once corralled. Though he released a new solo album Man of the Woods, his fifth on Friday, Mr. Timberlake is, in effect, a heritage act. The heritage of the early to mid-2000s, but still. His booking also displays the differing ways forgiveness is deployed in public life. That Mr. Timberlake was deemed fit for this rehabilitation has less to do with contrition on his part than the presumption that whiteness is resilient armor, and also the convenience of having a non-white scapegoat. In a year in which the N.F.L.'s bumbling relationship to race has been at its most visible, this whitewashing has a particularly acrid smell. On Sunday, in anticipation of Mr. Timberlake's performance, Twitter and Instagram were flooded with photos and videos of Ms. Jackson, often posted with the hashtag number Janet Jackson Appreciation Day. In the days before the Super Bowl, there was also a minor conflagration at a report that Mr. Timberlake would be joined on stage by Prince, in hologram form, causing offense to Prince fans, who knew he rejected such spectacles, to those who recall Prince's 2007 halftime performance One of the Greats, full of range, attitude, and carnal verve, and to those loath to see another black body handed over to a performer who had so famously mishandled one in the past. As it happened, there was no hologram, just a projection of Prince onto a gargantuan scrim as the lights turned purple, and a quick, inoffensive duet of I Would Die For You that served more as an exaltation than a musical performance. In that moment, Mr. Timberlake was small, of secondary importance. 14 years later, he's learned when it's best to be hands-off.